Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. We've passed the 150 episode mark. We're now on 151, and I am joined by kind of a returning guest. He was on the Sharp Dojo series way back when I did that under a pseudonym, a different name, but he's returned. He's titanium. It's Tom Atlas. Welcome to the show.
Hello, Billy. Thank you very much for having me back. Dash on the hi.
That's it. We'll go with that. So, like I said, off camera, we'll it's kind of a little bit of a soft reboot. If people want to go find the episode in the Sharp Dojo series, they can do, but I won't tell you the name. You could find it yourself. You could listen to all of them, and you'll find it eventually. I don't think it'll take you long.
From one, and you'll make it there at some point, right?
Exactly. There's only like 8 episodes, so just listen to them all, watch them all, and enjoy them. But in the meantime, so like I say, soft reboot. We won't do the old cliche questions, but we'll do some of them. But so as your kind of returning guest, I'll ask the kind of first question for returning guests. Just how are you? How's it going?
I've been doing really well, Billy. Thank you. Yeah, things are going pretty well. Just life as a whole has gone up since, well, last year and everything with last year and the last couple of years. Yeah, things are going well. I can't complain really.
Fine. It's weird, yeah. We say last year, we think, oh, it happened last year, all that kind of bad stuff. It was like, it's still 2020, we're in 2022 now. This 2021 just doesn't seem to exist in the world. kind of disappeared. But that's a whole other story that we're trying to get away from now, aren't we? 2 years later, as it is literally, when this episode comes out, I think it will be just like shy a couple weeks of 2 years since the incident. So we'll just avoid that entirely. So first up, we'll kind of go into how you got into wrestling. So first kind of favorite, so what was your first memories of pro wrestling?
Right, it's all a bit blended, weird. I pick things from here and pick things from there. There's not an exact starting point, but we'll just throw in what I remember. I remember the Hardy Boys, looking up them because one of my friends mentioned them, and start properly staying with it and watching it all the way through around 2012-13. Like, I think this was just after Twice in a Lifetime, and like the start of the rise of Daniel Bryan. You've got Rey Mysterio still popping off, the Shield are causing mayhem. It's around that sort of time where I properly got into it and got stuck all the way into it.
So yeah,
I definitely remember Big Show knocking out both Sheamus and Randy Orton for whatever reason. And what? It's just sort of stuck since.
What a trio of a team. I'm starting to remember bits and pieces from last time then. I remember it was, yeah, you made me feel incredibly old when you told me when you started watching. Must be weird watching the Hardys though, go back then, because when you started, they would have been an Impact, so they wouldn't have been, you wouldn't have been maybe as aware of their heyday, I suppose, as much until you obviously went back and watched it, because you're much like myself. You're very much, once you lock on to something, you want to find out everything about it. Which is why after 9 years I'm still doing a website about Scottish wrestling for some inane reason. Seeing the Hardys at that point, when you went back, did you realize why they were so, or first when you went to search them, did you end up going, oh, they've got a book series, this is quite cool, they're detectives?
I didn't know they were detectives. I didn't know they did that. That's interesting. I just generally looked up their matches on YouTube, as you do. Mm-hmm. And it was mainly Hardy versus Hardy that got me into things, because that's an underrated match. Like, it's just an absolute car crash, and it's a load of fun, and it's not taken too seriously.
That's the best way. That's always the best way of wrestling.
Wrestling is inherently bollocks, so you will go balls to the wall.
So Hardy versus Hardy, so that means you were introduced to Matt Hardy when he had tights then. That's kind of,
yes,
when you came in. So you didn't even have cargo pants, Matt Hardy, or V1 at that point. Oh, you were in for a treat going back through the Hardy catalogue. I could probably speak about them for far too long, being the mega fan I am, with literally their logo tattooed on my body. Everything Hardy's is good. All good stuff. I mean, nowadays, I don't know. I still love the Hardys, but sometimes I watch clips and go, no,
I saw that spot with Jeff Hardy and Darby Allin. I'm like, oh boy, you can definitely tell which one of them is younger at this point.
I know. I mean, I do love Jeff, but his last WWE run, everyone's going, he's amazing, and he is. He's great, and as a big fan, it pains me to watch it and say, he really is just doing all these cool stuff in slow motion, and it's still great, but it is in slow motion, and he's just, the part of you just goes, oh, I remember in 2000, well, you won't, but I remember in 2000 when he was doing his swanton off the stage at Madison Square Garden, off the entranceway, off a taxi into tables, and I thought, oh, I couldn't get any better than this, and then he does stuff like that, and I'm going, I mean, that is cool, but I don't want to see it. As someone who, like, their knees creak when they stand up now, I'm just like going, no, that's maybe a bit too much even for me. But who knows? Maybe in 5 years' time, we'll be watching YouTube and we'll see Tom Atlas doing something just as crazy. Maybe not as crazy. Maybe not the ladder spot, but you know, you never know.
Don't give me ideas.
So you did that. You watched the Hardys. We'll get off the Hardys. Because I said I'll be here all night otherwise. Into the early tens and the rise of Daniel Bryan. Seeing someone, I mean, I suppose when I was younger, it was all about the big dudes, big muscly dudes. And when you're getting into it, it's more about the art, I suppose, of wrestling. It's more about the finesse and yeah. But back in my youth, it was about big characters doing very little moves, but it was all crowd work. So when you saw the likes of Daniel Bryan, was he just the guy you gravitated towards at that point, or was there anyone else in particular that you were like, I need to watch this guy
absolutely.
More?
Absolutely. But I've always been attracted to more smaller, more technical-based wrestlers because I'm not the tallest guy in the world, right? I'm 5'5", roughly. So like, it means that I know I'm not going to be the one to necessarily throw folk about, although, you know, with PT and fitness and big boy stuff, I can move heavy circles, so I can move people. So that's the best way to look at it. But yeah, all the smaller guys I've always really gravitated towards, like, name anybody in NXT Black and Gold, because they were all cruiserweights and they're all fantastic. Mysterio, Brian, Punk, in a way. Gargano, Allen. Even Jeff Hardy would sort of fall into that mix as well.
Mm-hmm.
Just because he wasn't the biggest guy. He wasn't the biggest guy in the world. And he just mainly stuck to his stuff that was cool. So smaller, more tech, more cool-based wrestlers are what I've always stuck towards.
That's the weird thing about Jeff Hardy. Like you say, he was the small guy, and when he went to AEW, he looked at me and go, oh my God, he's one of the big guys here. this is a bit insane to look at, that he's actually huge in comparison. It's like when you see Billy Gunn. You don't believe the height of Billy Gunn until you see him in AEW or you see him in real life, and you go, holy fuck, you are huge. you're terrifying, but amazing at the same time. So he did that. And you into the wrestling, because I'm old now. How did you get into the indie scene then? So was it just by chance, or was it when you found your first wrestling school? Where did the independent scene, whether in the US, Europe, UK, where did that come in?
Indies was definitely through YouTube. I mind watching the WrestleHop News because I got into that. And then they were showing off some of the NGW stuff that was on YouTube at the time. And that really caught my eye and opened up my eyes to, oh God, this is UK-wide as well. That's really cool. So that's how that started. And then that sort of transitioned into more generally looking about the UK scene, specifically WCPW, since I was a What Culture fan. That sort of took off that way. And that was always pretty cool to see. So then that just slowly morphed into Scotland, going to the wrestling school. And then just from there, just bubble burst. I can see everything.
That's weird. It seems to be like, for a lot of, I don't know, more older people, WCPW, it seemed to be, it was like those youngins are doing the wrestling. I don't know if it's because mainly the people that they showed as the personalities were the guys from What Culture. And even at the time, I was like, oh, that seems a bit lame in my mind, and someone who's old. But it seems to be a lot, the younger generation Just that's how that was there in much like for my generation, it was Channel 4. It was the pay-per-views that went on Channel 4, Royal Rumble 2000 and Fully Loaded and all that kind of stuff. So it's just a modern way of doing the same thing. It's just that's how you get into it. And in saying that, I didn't like What Culture. I'd find it a bit too, I don't know, insidery for me. I like mine just to be a bit. I like my wrestling silly. That's just the way it is. But then I got into Cultaholic, and I was like, actually, these guys are pretty good. I feel ashamed that I waited this long to get into those guys and their personalities as well. I don't know. It was Matthew really that kind of convinced me to watch it. Not him directly, but he was on it. I was like, I like Matthew on OSW Review. I'll go check out these Cultaholic guys, and that's it. Every week, I've got the podcast and that all kind of back into WCPW. Like I say, it's that was the entry point for a lot of younger wrestlers, and NGW, that's a company I haven't heard in a long time. That's last time I heard about them, it was Nathan Cruz, and I think they had six, they'd have trio titles at some point, and Lionheart and Joe Hendry and Name Redacted held them.
Yes, I do remember that. So I'm like, oh, yeah, you've got some Scottish guys as well. That's nifty. Yeah, the main names I remember are your guys, like Zach Gibson's. Yeah. You had a really good match with Zach Sabre Jr. there. Rampage, Nathan Cruz, Matt Myers, who really goes overlooked. He's fantastic. Robbie X, Mark Haskins had a really good match with Sammy Callahan there as well. Like, there's a really, really good backlog of stuff down there in NGW. So, I do need to go back and properly give it a watch.
So for NGW, where did you kind of go from that point? So what was your first kind of Scottish experience then? Seeing as we're a Scottish podcast, I suppose. What was your first kind of experience there? Because YouTube, probably your ICW, I'm guessing, that would be the main, main place.
It was ICW, yeah. First ICW match I probably sat and watched was Gibson, RVD, and Lionheart,
That was
Belter. Obviously, being from Liverpool, I had a bit of a bias toward Gibson. Whether he's heel or not, I love him. And yeah, so that sort of got me hooked on that. I just sort of dipped and dabbed into some bits of ICW, some of your bigger matches and stuff. But yeah, from there, it was just, I went to, obviously, start training, this redacted. And it was okay. But my first indie show was FCW. I finished up at Perth College. I was like, right, okay, I'm going to go to a gym and I'm going to go to this place for the rest. And sure, fine. So I got finished. Workout was all right from what I remember. It was probably bench pressing me. And then went down to the Telf Institute. I was first one there. Stood around for ages. Like, don't know when I'm going to get let in, but we'll just wait. Then got a ticket. Went, sat down. And main memory from that show is Emily Hayden stole my glasses while she was making her entrance against Sam Emerson Jim. So that was a great experience. That night was fantastic. And yeah, just overall great time. And, you know, I just kept going back to the show after, and then the world ended. But now I'm there as a trainee and I really, really feel at home. Like, everyone at FCW, just, I couldn't love them enough. It feels quite weird to go from being sat in the crowd and going, these guys are pretty good.
Yeah.
To, you know, be on shows for them and stuff. It's a really cool transition.
Well, I'm going to dissect through all of that as we go through. But just for the first point, because I don't think we chatted about this in our last chat, but you said you're from Liverpool, and I don't know if, have you been up in Scotland for a long time? Because your accent seems to be a bit like, there's a little bit of a hybrid of everything in there, and I don't know. Much like myself, I'm up from the Northeast, so I don't think I have an accent, but apparently I do. Sorry, I paused for a minute because that was a weird moment where you took your hoodie off there, and I paused and I was like, what am I doing?
I've got this on my shoulder, which is a bit of a controversial thing. A lot of people just think I'm a big football hooligan, but I don't follow football that much anyway. To be honest, I support us when we're doing well, and that's about it. Stay away from it. But yeah, I was born in Liverpool. Funny story about my birth, I was actually born at 1 pound and 2 ounces.
Jesus.
I was like small baby, very light baby. Fit me in my hand and throw baby me for miles. Great. Yeah, that was what you call a shop, man. Anyway, so yeah, I moved up when I was three and we stayed in Cymru ever since. But since last year, I've moved out to Perth and I stay here on my own now. Quite a separate place in Perth, and I work at the gym. Just yeah, Perth is pretty, it's okay, it's all right.
I think that's pretty cool. Then you went from 1 pound to now you're like, not to steal too much from Looking Sharp here, but you're now ripped and jacked, and throwing folk about. No, with very little, well, by the looks of it, with very little problem.
I've just a small thick yeet, man. It's fine.
Big. I was. I don't want to steal you in a Roz here, but you're a big strong boy. That's pretty
Yeah,
much. You went from one pound to
I'm a
that.
smaller strong boy. Ewan's a bit bigger than me. I'm a small strong boy. I'm
Well,
not quite as
medium
shape
small
up
boy,
there.
a medium strong boy. So yeah,
Yeah, but
that blows my mind, and that, because, well, everyone knows by now. I've mentioned that often in these podcasts, but of course I'm due to have a child in August, and to think that the fact that 1 pound could prospectively be a thing that's in your hand is just, that just terrifies me and blows my mind at the same
like
time.
that's a lot, like 0.45 kilograms, or like I was like 0.5 kilograms, something like that. Like I'm now 180 pounds of atomic mass, so there we go.
Fair enough. I think I was like 10. I was a big one. I was a big lad at birth, and that terrifies my wife every day when I tell her that. Anyway, this is not about me. This is about Tom Atlas himself. So yeah, you did your first training school. So you say your first indie show was not even that school's shows or academy
No,
shows or anything like that. All right.
the first show I went to as a fan was Fair City, because at the time there was nothing around here that I know of, right? So I was like, okay, cool, I'll go check this out. Sure, it should be fun, and had an absolute blast. I just got to sit and enjoy it as a fan. I didn't dissect it too much. Everything was good. It was a lot of fun, and to see people that I knew from the other place there was also fantastic.
Absolutely. So when you started your training, though, you said it was fine. I said we're not naming the particular company. I think anyone who will know, they'll know, and that's all that needs to be said about it. But how did you find that initial kind of training? Because they trained on mats. They were kind of a bit simple and simplistic in their ways. Was that a culture shock for you when you're expecting to see a ring, and you're expecting to maybe do some flips on the first day, or a moonsault or two? What was your kind of thoughts when you first had your training sessions?
I didn't think too much about it, to be honest. Just so I didn't go in thinking, oh, I didn't do this, I didn't do that. I just sort of went into it with an open mind, just okay, just gonna go along, see what I can do, you know. And turns out, it's taking me somewhere, so couldn't have been that bad at it. Yeah, training there was good. Yeah, some little bits, just I feel like I've gotten better with FCW, and I feel more, what's the word? I don't want to say appreciated, because I don't think that's the right word, but I feel a bit more at home with Fair City. I'll be honest, I don't really want to spend too much time talking about the other place. Just
All right, that's fine. We'll move on then.
it was good, but I prefer Fair City, is the way I'll put it.
I suppose, I mean, I don't know too much about Fair City's training, and obviously I know the trainers. I've at least interviewed a couple of them in the past, or at least speaking to them face to face. I think I've actually stayed over at one of their houses during a show, so I know them a bit. So I feel like they're a bit more, I don't know, character driven. I don't know if you felt that was a bit more your style. You could do the cool moves, that's fine, but a little bit more character driven can make you feel a bit more, I don't know, bigger, larger than life, confident, and you can maybe play about and do a little bit more when you've got that kind of basis of training. Would I be kind of in the ballpark there?
Yeah, in a way, absolutely. It's less, you need to do this because we're telling you, and it's more just, okay, explore who you are a little bit more. You still do your cardio, you still do your drills, you still cover your basics, as every school should. But, when we're doing stuff, I feel like we have a little bit of free rein to just be ourselves in there, which, is awesome when, I'm still trying to figure out exactly who Titanium Tom Atlas is. Not the baseline. I know what I'm going for, but you're building on top of that to make it even better. And yeah, like, couldn't ask for better trainers as well. Like, the amount of support I get is just fantastic.
Honestly,
basically,
fair, safe,
good. We love them.
Yeah, we'll go with that. That's fine. I'll find a way to splice it. It's all good. I don't know. I'm so glad I've only got like 13 more of these to do, and then that's not to be finished because the internet is just absolutely driving me nuts right now. But that's my problem. So we're still going to have plenty of good chat. Fingers crossed. So yeah, move to FCW, and that's your first indie show experience outside of watching these. So some of the wrestlers you would have seen at the FCW show, you would have seen possibly on like your YouTube deep dives and seeing these wrestlers do the wrestling. Because you were kind of early in your rebirth of training, so to speak, at FCW, you're able to watch the shows, just switch off as a fan. Do you find yourself now, when you are watching shows, now you're a bit further into your progression and now you're actually wrestling on shows, are you still able to switch off, or are you a bit more like watching it going, oh, this is good. I like that bit of footwork. I could maybe use that myself. Do you find that your brain's switched now you're watching wrestling?
It's a little bit of both. Like, sometimes I can just sit and relax, but in the back of my head, I'm thinking, okay, this, that. I can still sit and enjoy it, but like, the little tips are going on back here, not necessarily invading it and making sure that, you know, being too into it and I can't enjoy it. I can still sit, chill, have a laugh with it. But I've always got the little bit sitting in the back of my head, like, okay, this, that. And it's quite a nice balance, actually, because it means I'm not too far into it and I'm not too far taken out of it, if you get what I mean.
Oh, yeah. You're not going to be sitting in the back with your arms crossed going, well, clearly they've started on the right foot, and that's just all wrong. And then that's just ruined everything. But you can just go, oh, that was ace, kind of thing at the same time. Yeah. So when you're kind of putting together your character, like, say you're quite avid in the gym, which I aspire to be, but I'm quite happy just eating and not doing anything about it. So when you were trying to put together Tom Atlas as a character, or just Tom Atlas in general, was there anyone that you took some inspiration from initially, or was it just something that you kind of pieced together from all these YouTube binges?
I've got a big influence from Gargano, if you couldn't tell from some of the bits of my moveset and stuff. But I'd say a big influence from Gargano, and then from there it's just sort of just being myself and doing what comes naturally in a way. Just letting myself relax and go out there and be myself. Mm-hmm. Rather than like forcing anything, like, I need to do this specific thing for this reason. Like, I feel like Titanium works for me because the elements of Titanium, it's lightweight, it's strong, it's versatile, durable, tough. Lightweight, strong, versatile, durable, tough. It suits me to a T, whereas like, I just need to be myself turned up to 11.
I like that. I like that you've put a lot of thought into your like moniker bit. It's not just like something random in the middle, like, I don't know, Tom Killer Atlas. It's like, yeah, killer. At least you, Titanium, you've thought it through and you've put all that together to take that in there, which is
like, a fact that surprises a lot of people. I'm only 66 kilogram or thereabouts, which means I'm actually really quite light, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and for what I'm shifting in the gym body weight wise, it's actually pretty high end, because benches over 1.5 times body weight, deadlifters over 2.5 times body weight, squats over 1.5. We all have our worst movement.
I know. I'm looking at you going, well, that's terrible. That last one, that's disgraceful. Yeah. As I'm sitting here, and the only thing I curl is possibly a burger or I think the last time I benched anything was literally sitting on one. I think that's the last time I benched anything. But you know, people have their things they like to do, and clearly, yes, obviously you enjoy like working on your body and doing that, whereas I just enjoy sitting here and speaking to the people that like to do that instead, which, you know, works for everyone. my this is a very random off question here, because when you wrestle, of course, you're not wearing glasses. And as a fellow glasses wearer, I'm very curious. Are you a contacts guy, or are you just hope? Okay,
Contacts.
right.
Contacts.
Because
I
I do
initially
know.
wrestled with them off, and I'm thinking, I can't really see anything. Sight's quite important when I really dig into it and think about it. So, yeah, I've transitioned into contacts on the rest of the days.
I was going to ask, because I know there's some wrestlers that are possibly legally or even legally blind while they're wrestling. So I'm just feeling, because as a guy, I can't do contacts. The thought of having my finger near my eyeball just gives me the fear. Again, another reason. It's very low end of the reasons why I'll never be a wrestler. But you know, it's on there. Just the thought of oh yuck. Anyway, yeah. So you're a contacts guy when you wrestle. That's good.
I'm a contacts guy, just.
I'm glad when I watch wrestling now that I know that you can see things.
Yeah,
That
because
gives me
I
comfort.
had one of my matches and I'm thinking, I can't see anyone in the crowd. I don't know what the reactions are. I should probably put some contacts in to so I can see them. And like say if I'm like if I'm ever in a big mad multi-man match, being able to actually see who's who would
Just
actually
help.
make a bit of sense because I'm incredibly short-sighted. If I take these off, I can barely see yourself. I can make out your body figure, that's about it. Like literally everything's a blur. So contact's probably pretty good.
God, a cruel host would have just changed my background to blur by the time you put your glasses on. That could have been a terrible thing to do, noting for future. So when you're speaking about multi-man matches then, that would have been your actual FCW debut, wasn't it? It was a pre-show battle royal, am I right in thinking that?
Yes, it was. Pre-show Battle Royal. And it was fun. It was a lot of fun. Just got to go with the guys that I'd learned with and I've trained with. And then Dickie Divers comes out and attacks me. But it was great. It was a nice little introduction, good way to get me out in front of the crowd where, I'd never been given an opportunity to actually even get out there before. I was just stuck in the little training school square, feeling like I was getting nowhere for the longest time. And here's a fun story about my first day of training. First day of training for FCW, I'm still living in Comrie at this point, the middle of fucking nowhere. So I'm staying in Comrie thinking, I need to get to Dundee. Okay, so I'm going to do it this way. I'm going to get a bus, I'm going to get a train, I'm going to get there, and then do the same thing back. Get to a train station, the trains are on strike.
Wonderful.
Shit. So I start, oh God, no, I don't know what to do. And then the guy in the taxi is like, I can take you there. And he's like, it'll be 50 quid, but I can take you there. I'm like, I don't have much of an option. Fine. So 50 quid to training, and I'm there before everyone because I've obviously got there really early. But yeah, I find that quite funny. I just got there, oh God, but I still ended up getting there somehow. It was such a good first day.
Dedication is what I'm getting here. With not just your time management skills, it must be they're impeccable by the
Oh
sound of
God,
it.
they're still horrendous, but anything travel-wise, I can get to a T most of the time.
I know, yeah, I'm very much the same. Where if you tell me where I need to be, I'm going to be there like way too early. But if you tell me to like, I don't know, do something around about house, I'm like, I can wait. I can wait. I can do that in 5 minutes, no bother. But oh, I need to be somewhere in five. I'll be there 10. I need the time. I don't know. Maybe it's an anxiety thing. I need to know my surroundings before I actually get to do something.
Well,
Find the
makes
exit.
sense.
Find the exits. God, imagine. I mean, I think not. I think more people would gladly spend 50 quid to get out of Dundee. the time. But that's a story for another time, I'm sure. But that wasn't actually your official. It was your official debut as Tom Atlas, but you did have a little bit of a run-in in the show beforehand, which I haven't written down. Because was it Red Gate? No, it wasn't Red Gate. It was a team that no longer can exist in this world, if I remember rightly, that you got jumped by.
Gospodanya.
Yes.
On that show, yes, one of the turnbuckles was a bit loose. I'm like, oh, don't worry, I'll go fix it. It's fine. Give me 2 minutes. I've got a little bit of time from the next one starts. I'm going out and fixing it. And yeah, one of the Russians kicked me in the balls. One of them kicked me in the balls. got thingied and I got attacked, and then we love Brody Adler. She came out to save me.
You were hitting the hammer and sickles.
I was hitting the hammer and sickles, indeed.
So that was your first kind of experience. It wasn't really, like you say, you didn't really have to do, you weren't Tom Atlas at that point, but what was it like just getting to the ring in front of a crowd, even if it was just to do the turnbuckle and get beaten up for a little bit? Was that just like, as soon as that happened, you're like, this is sore, but this is worth it?
Absolutely worth it. Absolutely. Like, even when I was setting up with some shows and up and out at the other place, I'm like, yeah, this is worth it. I think it's always going to be worth it, no matter where I am, where I'm helping out, no matter what I'm doing, it will always be worth it.
Well, that's the attitude to have. We've got a couple of questions, and we'll dive in a little bit more into your wrestling career. I think some of them might be overlapping, but the first question is from Omar Muhammad, very much a friend of the podcast. People, you won't have seen it because the episode hasn't gone out yet, but in the episode 150, he was on board with taking my phone during his entrance during his show at WrestleZone, and shouting into it, which was amazing. It was great for footage. And I had kids coming up to me afterwards going, did he just give you his phone? No, this is my phone. Go away. Go away, child. Leave me alone. Anyway, he sent a picture, and it's him putting on a modified chicken wing by the looks of it. And he's just asked for your thoughts on it.
Give me round two. I'm coming back for you, Omar.
It's a very intense photo there. He's using your own hand as well. Yeah. It's...
You didn't tap me out. I fainted, so I never gave up. So just keep that in mind, Omar. I am coming back.
We've got Ian Skinner. He's asked, tell us about the time you took a shoot GTS to the nose.
Oh, this is my favorite. I saw this question. I giggled in the middle of the gym floor and had people looking at me. So, you know how your nose sort of goes quite gently like that, yes?
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, very well.
Mine has a bit of a dent in it, if you couldn't see. I've got a bunch of skin here and it's pushed in.
Right.
So, I'm doing a training match, you know. We're going through, okay, we'll do a GTS, that's fine. Now, this is small Tom, nervous Tom, just, oh God, I'm in quite deep, Tom. And Skinner, greatest person, I love Skinner to death, he's fantastic. So we practice the GTS spot, okay, cool, we'll do it properly. Pops me up in the air, I panic, right? Just, oh God, what am I doing? Knee to the nose, right? And I was fine, just had tears going everywhere, but I was fine, I was smiling, still getting all my stuff. And yeah, so it turns out my nose has actually been pushed up into my skull, so where my glasses would normally sit up here, because of that, they now naturally sit down here.
It's completely like,
my fault. Completely my like fault. But it's quite funny when I look back at it.
Just makes you look more like an intellectual now. That's the way it does. That's the way it works.
Yeah, the moment I come down here, look.
No. So we'll dive into your career then. So Tom Atlas made their debut on January 2022, according to my research here, which is essentially going through the results on the SWN website, swnscotland.com, for those that want to go check out. There's also a really good article series called Future Shock, if you want to check as well. Yeah, no, really? I think you may enjoy it. The fact that there's not one...
I wonder which handsome bastard did that. Huh?
The fact that there's not been one done about Tom Atlas yet is just a disgrace. But maybe imagine.
Hopefully one day, maybe by
a different writer. I think otherwise it may be a bit weird.
I'm not that egotistical. I'm not Cody Rhodes, okay? Adam, you can borrow it if you're absolutely desperate.
I'm just imagining you've already got a draft written up. With the backstory.
Just it's 5 pages long. Just.
I mean, we take all sorts on the site. I spent a day at work. I mean, I didn't do it at work. I did it outside work hours. I drafted like a 2-page origin of the Bulgarian baker for my own enjoyment. And I put it on the site because...
Right, what's his finisher? What's the Bulgarian baker's finisher?
I didn't even get that far with it. He grew up in a town in Bulgaria and he joined the circus. And I think he wrestled Chris Jericho in Germany once, and it was and he gave Jericho gave him the name the Bulgarian Baker. It was ridiculous, And I loved every second writing it. It was just so stupid. It was the best thing ever. I don't know if it's actually still on the site. I don't know when I did the big clear out when stuff happened that I took it off because I thought it was a bit too silly even for people. Right, Bulgarian Baker. I'm going to find it now. And then we'll speak about your actual wrestling because that's what we're here to do. Bulgarian Baker.
I don't think I'm Tom Atlas anymore. I think I'm the Bulgarian Baker.
It is Half Baked, the Bulgarian Baker story, July 6th, 2015. It is still there.
That's far too good. I'm actually going to cry.
He was in an orphanage. That's where he is. After he's now daily beating by the staff, God, I went really dark with this. They found his stash of bread going through various stages of decomposing in a hole in his bedroom wall. I got quotes as well. I remember when I first tasted one of his pastries, it was so soft, it just melted in the mouth. He was special. Claudia Schiffer. The buns were unbelievable. When he put a burger in there, it was like I was giving the meat and cheese a big hug. David Hasselhoff.
I can't even take a drink. That's amazing.
Anyway, so yeah, that's why I don't do much writing anymore on the website. Because when I'm left to my own devices, I wrote that 4 days after my birthday. I must have felt really good about myself turning 25. And I was like, yeah. I know what I'm writing. I'm going to spend. Anyway, and well, we won't speak about your writing. We did that in the Sharp Dojo series, like at length. This is about your wrestling. I'm going to take that off my screen because I'll keep reading it otherwise. Because there's a very long segment about Chris Jericho. So let's move on. Redgate. So you're told you're getting your debut. The Battle Royal, it's a Battle Royal. It's cool. Everyone loves a Battle Royal Rumble style thing anyway, but it's not often, unless you're the guy throwing everyone out, it's not really a proper debut, I feel. So when you're getting told you're going to be on a main show against the Red Gate, what was your kind of reaction? Were you just like, did you feel ready for it?
Yeah, cool. Let's go. I'm in there with two really, really good guys. I've got a good tag partner there. Let's go. Let's just go do it. Like, I felt like after years of feeling like I wasn't quite good enough to get an opportunity to show that I might have something here with this, and I'm always going to appreciate FCW for improving my confidence and giving me opportunities like that. The opportunities they've given me so far have been amazing. So it did so much for my confidence. Went out there, just kept it simple, just did what I had to do, and it was good. It was a fun match. And I got to take some really fun stuff as well. So it really set up everything. And I had a lot to learn from that match that I've implemented since. Redgate, couldn't ask for better opponents, better people to be in there with. Just fantastic.
I suppose one of them, I can't remember his ring name now, is Jacob Deacon Wild, I think he's going by now. I remember JD Wild. And I was trying to remember, he goes by a long name now, which is great when I'm writing results. ADM, thankfully, is now going by ADM in most places on that note. So, of course, he's one of the trainers, isn't he, along with Kev. And is there anyone else who else is kind of...
Ian Ambrose, we occasionally have Serena Rose and Taylor Bryden take sessions as well.
Oh, so it's a pretty well-rounded group, especially with Ian, who we've interviewed. I do love Ian Ambrose. He has asked a question, which we'll get to when we discuss your match with him, but... He's obviously training at FPWA as well, so he's be able to bring a little bit of Andy Wilde's teachings over as well. So it must be all just, a good hybrid of stuff.
It's a fantastic school because it's a fantastic mix of everything you'd want and need. Like, out of everyone, like UNG Matthew especially has, for me, so much great character stuff that we get to explore. It's so much fun. Absolutely. But you've got the cardio with... Jacob Deacon, you've got the technical stuff and the psychology with Kev, you've got the drills and the cardio and the athleticism with Ricky, like everything, Taylor Bryden, sorry, you've got everything that you want in there, across a great variety of trainers. It's part of the reason why I feel so at home, not only because it's closer to me, like geographically, because traveling up to Airdrie every single Sunday and having to make my dad drive me there is a lot each week. And the fact that I can just go and do it on my own accord makes me feel a lot better because I'm not having to rope my dad into it.
Yeah, it gives you a bit more independence as well, because you're literally doing it yourself. You're not, like I say, you're not relying on people to get you there. And if they can't make it, well, then that's you missed a week of something that could be important. I mean, I'm sure at reputable schools they would kind of cover things at length. I have heard schools that have that I can't remember who I was speaking to, but it was a famed Dundee school that spent a week teaching lockups, but this person couldn't make that week. And the next week they moved on to something else, and this person didn't learn how to do lockup for ages because they never came back to it. And it just seems like that's mental to think of. But so yeah, so in that case, if that was the case, yeah, you missed a week because your dad couldn't take you. That's it. You've missed an integral part if you're at that school. Of course, you're not because you're sane. So you end up at FCW, and of course, I think guys like they'll have to have kind of guests come through. I think I remember Looking Sharp did a seminar as well, and so they've got a little bit of, like I said, a little bit of everything. Like you say, that you can pick and choose what bits work for Tom Atlas, and even if you learn it, at least you're prepared for. I mean, because I suppose because you're strength based, small but mighty, you're probably quite. Your skill set and your base is probably quite accommodative for anyone, really, big or small. But at least if you're against someone who's smaller than you've got the power. You can learn a bit about power. If you're someone bigger than you could learn about speed, I suppose. So it's nice to have a well-rounded teaching base. But do you find have you ventured elsewhere to find a bit more, like to an FPWA, like to anywhere down south to learn a bit more?
Not yet anyway. It's I would like to go explore and go other places, but just with work and stuff and clients and stuff. So it tends just to stick to what I can make home wise, but I will definitely eventually go exploring to other places and learn as much as I can, because that's in the stage I'm at the minute. Just I want to learn everything. Just give me as much as I can, let me learn everything, let me get experience and implement it. Make myself better going forward.
You find now that you've, because we've already mentioned that you watch wrestling and now you're able to kind of switch between analytical and just enjoying it. But now that you're properly, now you've started wrestling and you're against opponents and you've seen the people come through at FCW or come to the Fair City shows, or when we'll get to it, like Reckless Intent as well, because you made a debut there recently. Have you now been starting to watch specific like companies or specific like if for example Discovery, they're quite good at putting up all their events quite quickly afterwards. Is that so you watch all the Discovery stuff because that's a company that you could possibly get to in short order, or is there just any particular promotions that you're keeping an eye on closely?
Not necessarily. I do need to watch a lot more Discovery since I love what they're doing. Discovery is fantastic. I'm really looking forward to a Disco Derby. I might go along and watch it as a fan or see if I can come out. But yeah, there's a lot there that I'd want to cover, and there's a lot there that I'd want to watch. So I still mainly just sort of keep an eye on a bit of everything, just catch up with stuff if it goes up or where I can, but mainly just a bit of everything where I can. It's mainly the bit at the minute, but definitely want to go out and watch more for sure.
Yeah, so I was noticing that you do you're quite good at sharing just a bit of everything. When I was doing my research, realized I forgot that we were friends on Facebook as well. So I was going through. Oh, that's this guy's sharing quite a lot. Oh, I'm on your personal page. This is right. Okay, cool. So you're very well for putting like sharing everything on your personal account. Is that why you created the Tom Atlas Facebook page? Was there people? Was your friends going, dude, we know you like wrestling.
I don't care what they think on Facebook. I'm not me if you really want, right? I'm just a big wrestling nerd at heart, right? And I'm never going to apologize for that. So if you're on my Facebook and you see the wrestling stuff, at least give it a like. Come on, it's not that bad, is it? But yeah, just I just like getting everything out there, just because the Scottish wrestling really is popping off at the minute. It's great to see, and I want it to keep going. And I'd love to be a part of that properly at some point as well.
Like you never know as well, because I mean, for whatever reason, your friend could be up in because it's a cliche at this point. They could be up in Aberdeen, and you've shared that WrestleZone have got a show that weekend. And they may go, oh, you know what? I've got an evening to kill. I'll just go along to this show. It's at the whatever Northern Hotel. Prepare to bring your shorts because it's a fucking roasting venue. But you never know at the same time that could happen.
Like, I've got a lot of friends who are at uni in loads of different places. So I was like, hey, you know, like, I'll take one of Ben, for example. I believe he's up north. I believe it's Aberdeen. Sorry, I forgot that wrong, buddy. But yeah, like, if I ever end up somewhere around or up there, I can always just say, hey, bring an army to the show. Because if you saw a match with Ian Ambrose, I accidentally brought an army from Crieff, and it was a lot of fun.
All right, so we'll go through some of your matches then, and we'll get to that one with Ian, because I think that's probably going to be the one we'll speak a little bit about, because we do have some questions. Well, we do have a question from, Ian sent us it, but it wasn't him that asked it. So you had your match with Redgate, great. You had your match with Ewan, so that, again, another one of your trainers. He's one of those guys where I think I've only ever seen one match where he wasn't on. The rest of the time, there's always is Ewan Giamaki. He commentates his own match. He lampoons tropes in wrestling and all that kind of stuff. And it's just such an interesting watch. Like I said, only one time I've not seen that. And I've seen him wrestle for about the last 9 years, but coming up to 10 years now, I've seen him wrestle. So what was it like getting in with Ewan? Because that's quite a bit different. Because Redgate are supposed to be these like bad, broody, scary dudes, and then you go in with Captain Mackey, who's this lighter character, a bit aggressive, like a goblin. Well, he was a goblin, and now he becomes a pirate. What was it like with that shift?
I love that match so much. Like, it's something that I'm actually quite proud of, to go in there and just to be able to show what I can do against someone like Ewan. Like, because he's so good at what he does, I was able to play off it relatively well. And I just got to show off what I can do. Like, my favourite spot of that match was definitely just the really slow, delayed suplex. Because he didn't need to give me much on that. I was more just able to just lift him up, which was quite impressive in my stance. But, oh, holy shit, I can do that. And it looked a lot of fun as well. It's something I'd like to give another go, but I might need to get up to 70 kg first. And I just got to show off my stuff and just see what I can do. And I'm in there with one of the best across Scotland, period. Like, Ewan's one of the best around anywhere, and there's no wonder he's getting a lot of work in different places as well. It's fantastic to see him doing well, and I love him.
And then you had your match with Omar and Thaddeus Fogg in a triple threat. Omar, I'm assuming that's where that picture came from.
Yes.
Of you passing out to the, I don't know what he calls it, but it looks brutal. When I've seen Omar, he's been, he's a sensation anyway, but he hasn't really busted out his technical stuff on shows that I've seen him live wrestling in, but he keeps racking up these submission wins, so much so that every time I do results, when in doubt, I put by pinfall, and every time I seem to get a message shortly afterwards going, it was by submission that I won by. So that was, again, another different dynamic, three people in a match. Thaddeus Fogg, I'm not too familiar with him, but of course I'm familiar with Omar. Again, a lot of fun. Was there any moments that, other than getting choked out at the end?
Yeah, fantastic match, a lot of fun. Two other fantastic people, I should say.
You can call yourself fantastic if you want, I don't mind.
No, I'm not there yet. Thaddeus, fabulous, like, in both gimmick and person, fantastic to be in there with. And Omar is just fantastic. Just absolutely incredible to be in there with. Like, I learned a lot in that match, and I've implemented a lot of stuff since, and it's been a lot of fun, and I can't wait to hopefully get in there with Omar again at some point.
Omar is quickly becoming one of my absolute favorites, and seeing his development, because first time seeing him was an FCW show on YouTube, but he was really skinny. He was like a really quite a slim dude, and I saw him at Aberdeen Anarchy this past Saturday. He's big. He's a big boy now.
He's tall as well, which I'm like, I definitely need to get bigger, because I'm like a lot more compact than him. So I'm hoping next time I'm standing next to Omar, I'm more out here. So,
but no, it's scary how quick he's evolving. He's quickly joining the big boy club.
Omar is like when you just main one Pokemon at the start and you just use that Pokemon only, and it just goes sky high.
Yeah.
It's, you take a Mudkip to a Swamp Heart in like 10 minutes. That's how quickly Omar is evolving. He's incredible.
I like you meant Mudkip. My thought was Totodile to Fralligator. That was always mine.
No, Mudkip. Mudkip. Always.
Nah. I'm older than you. It's Fralligator. Blastoise. I don't know why I always went for water types, because fire was the cooler ones to see, but I don't know. I always had an affinity to the water types.
Like, I'm not the biggest Pokemon guy, but I did buy a Game Boy and I got Emeralds as well.
Pokemon game.
So I was thinking, I had the choice between Torchic and Mudkip. I'm like, you know, Torchic could make an interesting playthrough, but Swampert is literally the most overpowered Pokemon in this generation. Yes, please.
Oh, memories playing Pokemon. Emeralds where I stopped. It got too far after that. The Pokemon they started getting sillier. And I was like, no, I'm quite happy. I will finish at third gen. That'll do me. I caught Rayquaza. And I thought, that's fine. That's it. I've completed this game now. Don't need to do anything else. For those Pokemon, I know there's plenty of people listening to this that love Pokemon. So the fact that you're saying that you're not a big Pokemon guy, you might regret that. I can just imagine.
I'm so Brody. Sorry. Please, nobody hit me with a chair.
Just imagine Brody's going to be in your DMs very quickly after this, going, right, but this, you should play this. See this Pokemon. He's cool.
Where's my notepad? Where's my notepad?
Here's Rotom. I fucking hate Rotom. Rotom, it's motor backwards, as you can tell. But if you look up Rotom, if I remember rightly, he turns into different things, including a lightning rod, a washing machine at one point, looks like an oven, a fridge, a lawnmower, and a fan. And I hate it, because that's too far. That's too far. I wrote a dissertation on the Bulgarian Baker, and I find that too far in Pokemon. And that ice cream one, that one can die. I'm very passionate about things, Tom. None of it's important, but I'm very passionate about things. You can ask me anything about ongoing court cases that are being dissected on Twitter anytime. I won't have a clue. But if you ask me about Rotom and how much it's stupid, I will go at length about how stupid this Pokemon is. Anyway, right. So we'll get into match Ian Ambrose. So absolutely screech at a halt there and go into the match Ian Ambrose, because this is where we're up to next. April 2022. So this is your first proper, I'd say your first proper singles match. I mean, you had one with Ewan, which was your first singles match on a show, but this is your first kind of little story-based one. Got to do some promos. You got to be involved. And Ian is probably one of the kings of promos in Scotland, certainly. The match itself, his question is, on behalf of Scully, why are you such an unsafe worker?
Right, sorry, I'm the unsafe worker here. Okay, sorry, Scully. So basically, that little plastic prick really did my nut in when he called me Tomatis, right? You don't do that, right? So as he was being rolled across the ring, my dad, Stevie Wizard, failed to catch him. So we'll get into that later. Wizard failed to catch him, so it was a little bit dented, right? Obviously, I had the thing where Rose distracted me by throwing Scully at me. I caught him and he punched me. And I was like, oh, God, that hurt. Obviously, I dropped Scully towards the floor. He smashes, right? I'm the unsafe worker here. You should blame Ambrose. He's the one who punched me. You know, like, if you wanted to stay safe, that's not my responsibility, Scully.
If anything, it's Wizard's fault.
Yeah, Dad, come on.
Right, you have to explain that to me then. So, Steve Wizard is your dad. Is it just because you both have glasses?
No, he's just my biological father. Just, it's a little known fact. Wizard is my dad.
We've broken it here on the podcast. He's now going by the Jericho Stevie Wizard, which I love.
The Jericho Stevie Wizard is Tom Atlas's father. Although it's, I don't know how long he's going to be my father for, since he's going to come out, I might get a new dad. But, you know, Wizard is my dad, in case you didn't know.
So we've got loads more questions, but we'll wrap up kind of here because we've only got one more match to kind of speak about. So we'll finish the match portion and go to the questions. Actually, guys, how have we surpassed an hour already? That's ridiculous.
I think it might be the roll Tom chat.
Or maybe. It was there was definitely a good 10 minutes on the Baker. That might have done it.
I'd happily spend an hour on the Baker and just I have
tales to tell about the Baker, none of which are true, but I've got tales I can tell about him.
I'll happily go put a fireplace on, grab a coffee, and just sit and chat with me about the Baker.
In the meantime, everyone can go check out Half Baked, the Bulgarian Baker Story on swnscotland.com. That'll help my hits. If this episode goes out and I get a couple of hits on that article, I'll know it's worked.
I think a certain someone might need to make a future shot on the Bulgarian Baker.
Oh, man. Oh, the tales you could tell.
I don't have a free evening. I believe Tom Humphreys, whoever he is, has a free evening. So,
I've heard he's a good writer. Well, that's why I was going to say, that's why I employ him, but I don't pay. I pay him in experience. That's the way.
I think that's why he doesn't write anymore.
Fair.
That's a joke. No. I believe he's just got caught up in other things and he will get back to it at some point.
That's absolutely fair. I think, like any of our writers, it is completely voluntary. So if you do put stuff, I appreciate it. But yeah. You get paid in experience. Maybe I've got some pennies in my pocket. If I'm going down the whole route there. Oh Christ, Jesus! I'm gonna need those pennies back. I broke my microphone. Right. So Reckless Intent, you made your debut. Just at this point, it would have been a couple of days ago, but in the podcast canon, a couple of weeks ago. What was it like getting involved in Reckless Intent? Was it Tillicutry or was it the Livingston show that you?
It was the Livingston show. I was around having it all weekend, but it was absolutely awesome. Just fantastic place to be, fantastic environment, fantastic people. And yeah, the match was really good. I was in the snow. One of Sheik's guys from down south. Really fun match. Just kept it basic, but kept it moving. And just everything went well. So some little points to take away there that I'm definitely going to start implementing. But had a lot of fun and got to be in front of a new crowd and a new place. It was really cool. Also got to debut some new gear as well, which was quite fun.
I've seen the Snow name pop up a couple of times now. I think he wrestled Target recently as well. And every time I looked at it, I find it funny. I like weather-based names. I don't know why. They always just tickle me. It's like, Snow. There. That's your name. Snow.
Yeah, it was... fantastic. Had a lot of fun and I hopefully will be back at some point. But
he didn't give you the cold shoulder at all? No, he didn't. I can't think of any more weather-based.
No, but it got quite a warm welcome and it was quite nice to be there.
Nice. Right, so that's your wrestling career as of this moment in time, Dan. So let's go look at, I don't know how much you can tell me about your future matches, whether they've been announced or not. That's it. I'll tell you you're productive. You can tell me or not. But I've got loads of more questions to ask you.
I'll just say no one. Let the ether decide that. Just
no bother. Right. So let's start
find out. Maybe follow the Titanium Tom Atlas Facebook page. It might be on there. Who knows?
There you go. We'll get the old social media plugs at the end. So people stay tuned and you can get them all. We've got John Pollen on Instagram. He asked, do you have a favorite style of match and do you have a favorite submission move?
Oh, favourite style of match. Anything cruiserweight based. Whether it's technical, fast, just cruiserweight stuff is always a lot of fun. Just sit and just enjoy. Junior matches are also quite fun to participate in as well because you get to do a little bit more fast paced stuff than what you want. It requires a lot more cardio, but it's also very good.
Excellent. Submission and move.
Favourite submission move, probably the Gargano Escape.
I'm not surprised.
Interesting.
Interesting
little take on the crossface, which is quite cool.
Mm-hmm. That's crossface, but puts a leg over the head, kind of shoulder thing. I'm trying to remember what the move is now, I like people do variation. I like seeing Omar's chicken wing variation. I like when people just do a little bit of add a little bit of spice to a move. I'm just doing a little salt. Oh, my camera's there. Salt bay. I'm into the memes. I'm 31. I'm not dead.
I
shouldn't call them the memes. That might age me terribly with these things, but you know. Ian Mitchell, a bit of a good question. Do you think you'll be champion one day?
I don't think that's it. I don't think that's really up to me in a way. I think it's more, of course, I'm always going to put the work in. It's whether somebody trusts me enough to hold a belt. And that's, I'm always going to work, do the words. I'm always going to put 110% into this because it's the thing I've wanted to do since I was 10. It could be cool at some point, but it's not up to me. But I'm just going to always keep working hard and striving to get better in the ring, better outside of the ring, and just keep on going. And then if it happens, it happens. But at some point, it may be quite cool. But my main focus at the minute is just getting better and better and better in terms of every single sense of wrestling.
So you're not hinging on getting a belt, but you've been getting belts like you're kind of, I always say trophy because that's not really what I'm going for, but this is the promoter going, right, we trust you. Here's why. Here's
proof exactly
that we trust you because we're giving you a run with a belt.
Until somebody goes, okay, you're getting this. It's not necessarily that I want it. It's more just like, if I get it, cool. It means I've proved myself enough. But then the real work starts in.
Absolutely.
But I will say the FCW junior belt is back there.
Absolutely. And the fact that, well, they're two champions so far, Kane Caden and Taylor Bryden there. By the sounds of what you're talking about, your style and that, they're just right into your wheelhouse to kind of continue that lineage of that belt anyway. Eventually. You know, maybe sooner than you think. Right, we've got Callum Bruce asking when you're coming north. So we already kind of had a chat about you wanted to wrestle everywhere. But yeah, when are you coming up to when are you coming to Aberdeen? When are you coming to Combat League up in Caithness? There's plenty of places up here now.
Well, ideally when I can, as soon as possible. But at the end of the day, just depends who wants me where. And of course, I'm always going to try to do my best to put myself out there. But
let's get a couple matches in. Yeah, let's get a couple more matches in, and then before you spread your wings.
We'll just keep on going how we're going at the minute. And then when I feel ready to expand, we'll go.
Excellent. And we've got a question from Adam, of course, another writer on the SWN website, along with that Tom Humphreys guy. Johnny and Candice come to FCW. Who are you choosing to team with you?
Ava. Ava was a fellow trainee at Name Redacted, and she's always been one of my best friends, my biggest supporters, and my biggest fans. She's no longer involved in the wrestling circle, but I'm a massive Johnny Mark. She's a massive Larry Mark. We were always wanting to have this idea of being an intergender tag team, just because, you know, we're the World's Greatest Tag Team 2.0, but one of us is a prick. Yeah, so that was the whole idea. So if they ever do come, I'm roping Ava back into this whole bollocks, and she's doing it with me. She doesn't have a choice. I love you and I miss you, buddy.
Fair enough. Now, I think the last time we did do the two classic questions, because I'm fairly certain you had a very long answer about the two sheep, one cow situation. I don't know if you are aware, but I've mentioned it in a previous video since Leo McLean showed us the evidence, but there is a video online of a sheep versus a cow.
No,
it's amazing. It's incredible. So I don't know if I can't remember what your answer was at the time. I don't know if you've got if you've thought about it since then, but have you got any rebuttal, any new evidence, any new thoughts on the whole two sheep versus one cow situation?
Two sheep, one cow. I think it still has to be two sheep, if that's what I said. Just two versus one, like, sheep have horns, they're more dangerous. A cow's just sort of there. Like, you've got the whole dynamic of they can move around you and there's two of them and they can sandwich you, whereas the cow's just sort of trotting along, not doing much.
Yeah, I'm still in the two sheep crowd camp. That's the word I was going for. But yeah, the video kind of confirms that. I'll send you a link to it. It's amazing. And I did ask you about the dinosaurs, but I feel like now that I've already asked the other guy, the Bruce Banner, so to speak, and I'm going to ask the Hulk.
Clark Kent.
Oh, you're a DC guy. Okay, fair enough.
No, not even. when I started growing my hair out, my dad always called me Clark Kent because I had this massive fuck off quiff. So you know, the other guy, Tom Humphries, I believe he's the Clark Kent to my Superman or whatever it is.
It could have been worse. When I was younger, I had glasses, and my dad gave me like a number two haircut every couple of weeks. He called me Brains from Thunderbirds. Just let that one digest for people.
That's very fun.
Yeah.
What comparisons? There was a really dumb photo of a really young Celtic kid with glasses. You know, bald Celtic kid, and I always got compared to him in school, and I'm like, come on, love that. It's a classic. I don't know where it is. I'll see if I can find it at some point and send you it. But oh, that was the comparison that I got, and it wasn't.
Yeah. Oh yeah, Brains is mine, which I thought was. I think he meant it as a compliment because I was quite intelligent when I was younger. Don't know what happened after that, but yeah, I did look like Thunderbirds, Brains from Thunderbirds. Yeah, well, anyway, yeah. So what's Tom Atlas's favorite dinosaur then? Has he got a different answer to Clark Kent?
I don't want to steal somebody else's answer.
You'd steal it. Go for it. If everyone, hey, much like wrestling, dinosaur loving is subjective. You can love the same dinosaur, so to speak.
Can't remember what Tom Humphries said, but I think it is the Funkosaurus, Brodus Clay, and the Funkadactylus.
I don't think that was his answer, because I think I would have remembered that, because that is an incredible answer. Yeah. Wow, it seems, I don't know if anyone can hear that, but it seems to be an ice cream truck outside that's telling me to wrap up this episode.
Oh no, we've talked too much shit about Rosa. Oh God.
We spent too much time on the baker. That was a downfall. I can't believe that.
My favorite part of this.
I hope other people appreciate it and enjoy it, because it's, yeah, we find it funny. And that's the most important thing when we're talking on a podcast, is letting the time go by speaking ridiculous things like the inane Rotom. Arsehole of a Pokemon. Anyway, right. So that's what's your future then? You've already covered things that you just want to get better, get wrestling, and then we'll see what goes from there. And we'll add a fantasy element to the question then. Vince McMahon phones you. He goes, Tom, I'm not doing an impression. I don't know why I started doing that. Tom, we're giving you the main event at WrestleMania. You get to choose your opponents, the stipulation, and everything about it. So it could be a multi-man match, it could be anything. We'll bring anyone in that you want. You're the main event. Who is it? What is it? What's the match?
Johnny Gargano, straight up singles match, Intercontinental Championship.
Oh, nice. Would you bring back an old IC belt, or would you go with the
I'm bringing back the white belt, absolutely.
Ah, nice. Fair. I mean, you're in charge. So just straight up singles. Is there a time limit? Is it Iron Man or just straight up singles?
Straight up singles, first to pinfall, no time limit.
Excellent. Any special guest ref? Just throw that in there.
Any special?
I'll throw a curveball into this thing, haven't I?
Not anyone I could think of at the minute, to be honest.
No, we'll just make it of Jimmy Corderas. There you go. That's the first referee I've thought of. He could be the referee for the match. Yeah. Excellent. Right. So, like I said, I can't believe an hour and a half has passed, and I feel like we could probably speak for another couple hours.
I'm happy to.
But it would end up just us finding things that we're annoyed about and just going on rants about them. For a good bit, and I would enjoy that, but I don't think other people may. I mean, who knows? Maybe we'll if the podcast returns for a season 5 in the future, because it might. We'll have more things to whinge about and rave about in the future, I'm sure. But in the meantime,
maybe Rotom might have another form that you don't like.
Oh, hang on! Does Rotom evolve? Oh, that's fine. Rotom, there is an evolution. No. Oh, that's fine. God, I put in Rotom E and Google said Rotom Evolution. I was like, oh, no, there can't be. It does not evolve. It just takes one of 5 additional forms, which are all stupid. It doesn't say that on Google, but that's what it means.
You want to know what I want to see?
Right.
A Rotom tractor.
See, I could be the grass type.
Yeah,
I mean,
exactly.
I still hate it, but you know, well, it's like, the grass type's a lawnmower. So I mean,
it makes a lot of sense.
It gets a bit closer, but the fact that the ice type is a fridge, that's just ridiculous.
Rotom RPG, you know, just that'd be pretty fiery, wouldn't it?
Oh yeah, and when you come up to things, it's like, oh no, it's a tree. You must turn into fucking whatever. Never is a Pokemon that I've never actually caught and played a game with has annoyed me so much. But anyway, we'll move on. I was trying to wrap up and I got distracted by Rotom again. Right, where can people find out more about Titanium Tom Atlas?
People can find Titanium Tom Atlas at Titanium Tom Atlas on Facebook. I will also plug my PT and fitness stuff, Tommy Atlas Fitness. I'm a personal trainer, online coach. All wrestlers get 25% off all my stuff. If you need a hand fitness-wise, gym-wise, etc., please feel free to come out of the chat. I'm very happy to help you out. And yeah, just mainly the Facebook page, not properly on Instagram one, but if you could follow the fitness one on Instagram, that'd be pretty nice, as well as on Facebook. Yeah, but if you guys just keep an eye out for everything that FCW is doing at the minute, just it's home and it's great. And everyone's doing well, so.
Perfect. Well, great. Well, thank you very much. I'm so glad we had this catch-up. Like I said, I can't believe the last time we had about an hour chat, and I don't know what we spoke about, but I don't think it was anything that was in that episode is in this one, which is always good when we're doing catch-up things. So, yeah, next time I speak to you, you'll probably have all the belts.
Yeah, well, just give me one black belt in particular.